Hello, I'm Stefan Hild, and I discovered Ada around 3 years ago and started to teach it myself using this tutorial from Wikibooks. I can really recommend it. In my opinion, it's the best online tutorial out there, or the best I had found. And also, I used Rosetta Code. It can you give good solutions for small tasks you maybe need. And because if you want to learn a programming language, you have to program something. I directly start to program a role-playing game. Because if you don't know much about a language and don't know much about game development, you start, of course, programming a game. Yeah, it's the source code exactly look like this, and but it compiled. Yeah, don't talk again, okay? Don't talk about this. Don't ask questions, I can't answer them probably. And later in 2020, I started to program a new game, a turn-based game at first, that later became a Civilization clone, Civilization-like game. First in the console, with to make the background systems. And recently, I started to switch to the SFML. It looks not so much different, but I'm working on it and I hope I can sell it at one day, hopefully. Yeah, and I also streamed the whole development of this game on my YouTube channel. 348 videos. Oh boy, way too much. And also on Twitch. And no one is forcing me to say that I'm streaming it. No one, no. Don't worry. No one is asking, forcing me. And now I want to talk about some advices and few things I discovered while programming a game without knowing too much about Ada and game dev, mostly about Ada. And we begin with some basic things. At first, don't make a Spark game. I tried it at first, but I give up at some point because you change often things and then you have rewrite all the contracts that Spark want. Also, you probably need for a game features that Spark don't have, like random numbers, or as I know, Spark don't like random numbers. And give my game big part of Spark wouldn't be a feature I hope I can put in later in a future version, but at the moment it's for me it's more important to make a simple game in Ada than a game in Spark. But what I would advise is to go in your project settings, warnings, and put them all on except the body information here. Probably there's a use I don't have for it. But the thing is, sometimes the option will give you an annoying message and you have to write a minute, work a minute on your code to fix this message. It's annoying, but it's still better than don't have them on, later discover you have a problem and you have to change big part of your code because, yeah, you have to fix this error. And no, you don't need a minute, you need a minute and several days, yeah. So I give you the advice, put them all on. Except if you want really fast make a game, but then maybe Ada is the wrong language anyway. Also the validity checks, you can make them all on. I never had problems with that. And some style checks, you probably the nesting thing. I know you can nest many things in Ada, packages and all the stuff, but just because you can, don't mean you should. And it will become unreadable if you're nesting too deep. So it would give you a limit. Also, if you use gnatv8, gnatw8 as a command, you can use some UTF-8 symbols like I did in the console version with the pointer directly in your code. It's a really nice thing. And wrong pen array. And if you want to add libraries to it, you have, yeah, I search it again. Yeah, it's dependencies, and you have to add your library here. Don't put it directly in your project. I did it wrong at first because I don't know what I'm doing most of the time. And yeah, so this is some basic things that I think is a really good advice when you start also. And now we switch over to some string handling that is really annoying, Ada, sometimes if you do it wrong, if you don't know it, and yeah. Yes, string handling in Ada. Ada have many several types of strings, and if you use a version of Ada that 2005 or newer, then you have the normal version of the strings, the white version, and the white version. And most of them you can completely forget if you program a game and just can use unbounded white string, because you don't have to worry how long your string is. I mean, it's of course not completely unbounded, but it's long enough to store files from text or user input, and also you don't have to worry if you change your text, if you translate it, if you rewrite it, whatever. You do this probably really often. And also, if you program a game, or at least for a modern system, you don't have to worry about the memory it uses. I mean, of course, the white version uses more memory than the white or normal version, but it's just background noise in a game. I mean, the map of my game, where all the information about what is what saved, it's eats most of the memory and it doesn't contain any strings, and it's just not important. So you can just use the white version, and it's a complete UTF-8 into it, so you don't have to worry about special characters if you translate it to another language like German, and then you have things like "eh". And in a long case, you probably need some strings, white strings, where you exactly know how long it is, but this is not so often, or at least, yeah, not that I use it so often, because yeah, you have to worry about the length, and it's really annoying if you have programming a game at least. Also, you probably need the unbounded, two unbounded white string, two white string, because many things like the SML wants a string and an unbounded string to give it through, and yeah, you have to convert it, and also this probably needs some calculating power, but it's also not important for a modern game. And also you should use white character if you use characters for some reason, for example the C, because you can directly use the complete UTF-8 and it's really good. Sometimes you will need other strings, and this is the point where you get really annoyed. For example, if you use the directories, because this is introduced into Ada 2005, if I correctly informed, and it only has strings, and then you have to convert your string to an unbounded white string or something to work with your internal structure, and it's really annoying. Transform strings, and then it doesn't have special characters like and then you have to rename your file. It's really annoying. So except for this, only use white string and mostly unbounded, because whatever you think you can save in memory with smaller strings, it's not important in the game. It's just annoying to transform your string so it can hold correct characters, and yeah, don't make your life worse, just use unbounded byte string and convert it how you need it. It's the easiest way, I think. Good, now we had some string handling, so let us do more string handling. Yeah, you will have many strings to handle. This time the image command, or the white image version of it, the white version of the image command. Probably needs this if you have some numbers and want to print them out as text on your game. I'm not sure if you can read this. I can make it bigger, but don't ask that. Egal. And yeah, you have to know several things about that. At first, it's important to know if the thing is positive or bigger equals zero. It will get an empty space beforehand. And if it's smaller, then you get your minus. So you have to trim your string, or it will kill your formation of your text in your game. And the second thing is, if you do it with float, using it with float, you get version of it, like, instead of 1.00, you probably want, like, you have 1.00 move points. You instead get normally the scientific version of it, and it's important. And yes, this is probably not the way you want to show your moving points. So you can convert it, but bring some weirdness of the library. At first, you have a wide TextView version and a wide integer TextView version, but the float wide version is a GNAT internal unit. So you have to make your own package right from wide text.io, or you can use float text.io, but this is only for normal strings, so you don't want to use it. And also, you have to GNAT. And yeah, then you can use your put to change it and can say, hey, I want it like that. What is a little bit problematic if you start programming, because at first you think, yeah, put, I use it, but put prints something on the console. I think it's set put, I'm not sure, because there's no comment. And actually there's an next put. Also, this is not the correct put. No, this put. With this put, you can convert your float text into normal number text, also from this to this. And it's a little bit complicated if you're beginning programming, because someone say, yeah, just use put, but put print on console, and then you scroll down and find out, oh, there are more puts without any comment. And yes, the standard library love to do this. Like, we have 8,000 procedures called put in 300 files, and it's sometimes confusing. So if you read, hey, use put for that, and it doesn't work, you use probably the wrong put. Also, it's a procedure, of course, because a function wouldn't be, yeah, give information in and get one information out. Yeah, you don't use function for that. Also no comment. And as I know, Ada can have up to 200 characters for procedures and variables and all the stuff. And yeah, they named it all put. Also, they named many things get. Yes, it's sometimes really confusing. And I give you the advice, I know you can do this in Ada, like name anything the same if you, and also the name of the parameter you get in, as long as the tip is different, Ada accepts this. But you should not do this in your program. It gets confusing, especially if you don't work for a longer time with this part of your code, and then you have many procedures with the same name and nearly the same input parameter names. And don't do this. It's, you will hate yourself, believe me. I of course have never done this, but I heard of people. Yeah, so it's a little bit confusing. I thought this was important to mention, because I need a while to figure out which put of the many things. And yeah, so, and don't, or at least if you do it, comment it, so you can understand it later. It's problematic science. So, not completely string handling, but a little bit. yeah, you handled many strings in games. Input output. Ada has many different things, at least four different types for reading and writing data. For game, probably is two important things: text I/O and stream I/O. Text I/O, of course, for text and only for text. For example, you can read text you want to play in your game and different language and all this stuff. And for anything else, you should probably use stream I/O. At first, I tried to put my database in some text file or simply to editing file using other methods, and as I'm really too dumb to do it, or it just is so complicated, but I had really big problems, so at some points I was so annoyed I changed to StreamIO to just write it there and write later an editor for my databases. I have still to do this because it's really annoying to not do it. So if you don't have only text or something else, you probably use StreamIO. You will have this for your unit database or something. And yeah, also if you read your text, of course, only read it into an unbounded while write string. And yeah, don't work around like, yeah, but I can save 20 kilobytes if I use this crazy method to read my data and write it. It's still not important in a modern game, and it's, yeah, you will not save memory with it. Probably not now. It's many other things in your game will eat up so much memory, and that this is not important. Yes, this was my talk about my experience and some advice about Ada and GameDev. Originally planned to put more things into it, like why it's important to make games with Ada and things about this task system and so on, but it took me longer to read talk about this stuff than I thought. So maybe you can ask me the Q&A, or maybe I make a video on my channel later. Couldn't do this. And yes, I also want again to say that I stream all my stuff, programming stuff, on YouTube. Damn, so much streams. And on Twitch. And I'm still not forced to say that I stream all this stuff. No one is forcing me. No, don't worry. And yeah. So have fun and bye.
Well, we should be now live. So thank you for your presentation, Stefan. And now we get to the Q&A. But before we get to the questions from the public, I have a personal one. And that is, how did you learn about Ada? How did you find out? Do you have any previous experience in other programming? And why did you decide to do a game with Ada? That's an interesting story.
I'm not sure how I discovered Ada. I just found it someday and looked at it, and I liked it and started working with it. But I tried to make a game with other language before, like C, C++, or engines like Unity. But I really don't like the C syntax. And also the compiler in this language is not really helpful with these messages. They are long, but meaningless for me. So I never found the right way to work with this language. But then I discovered Ada, and I just started trying it out like some other language, and yeah, somehow it sticks.
Okay, very interesting. And how long have you known about Ada or worked with Ada?
I think the first time is 3 years ago, but I probably start working more with it around 2 years ago. Caused some time problems and stuff.
Okay, so we have a comment from Stefan Carres, who says, yes, strings are annoying in Ada compared to some other languages. I thank you for covering that topic, because a lot of people don't really know that much about strings or are unaware of the complexities of Ada.
Yeah.
And especially for showing the example where a user can just name a city or something and they can just provide any symbol or issue. Was that a major issue with the language that you had to fight through, or
at the beginning was a problem because many tutorials just cover the normal string or normal ASCII signs, and you have to figure it a bit out for yourself, especially if many things have all the same name in the standard library, like the 5,000 puts you have in there. But after a while you get it, and if you be consequent with the using of wide strings, then it most of the time works.
Okay. And I noticed you're using a library for the game. How did you discover that library? Nowadays we have this package manager known as Allier that manages dependencies and finds out different projects in the internet that are indexed. How did you find the I believe SML?
ASFML, yes.
ASFML.
ASFML. ASFML. I first searched for the for some libraries like the SDL or SFML, and then you can just go under bindings, and then there's a list of bindings, and one of them was the ASFML. And because it was active maintained, I chose this. I know there was a binding for Allegro 4, but the link seems dead. And I'm not sure the state of the SDL binding, so I chose this one.
Okay. Thank you. And so you showed two versions, the terminal version and then the graphical version.
Yes.
So I suppose that's when you start using the SFML library to do that transition. However, for the terminal version, were you using just the standard strings and string manipulation tools that Ada provides to draw things on the terminal, or what were you using?
Yes, the standard thing and some CSI, this extended terminal commands. This is why it doesn't work correctly in Windows, because it's disabled at standard, I think. But looking good graphically wasn't the main purpose at the beginning, because I just wanted to integrate the background systems and all. And I thought it's probably easier if I don't directly start with another big library like the ASML. And it's easier this way.
So we are nearing the end of the Q&A. I would encourage all the speakers to come to the room. The bot will publish the address. It may take a few seconds. It seems that it has a bit of a delay, so be patient, please. And you can come here to this room and have a direct conversation with Stefan if you want. So thank you, Stefan, for your efforts, and see you.
You too.